Hello and welcome to GYC 2018 in Houston, Texas. I'm Jason Bradley and I'm here with Jill Morricone, and we are happy that you could join us for this wonderful event. We have so many young people that are pouring in right now, and if you've had the opportunity to see some of the other coverage of GYC, you've seen that it is a rich blessing and that young people are on fire for the Lord. And tonight we have a very special message that's going to be brought to us. And you know, one of the things that I've seen that is the recurring theme is the fact that people keep praying for the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. And something that I'd like to ask you to do at home is to pray for the outpouring of the Holy Spirit over all of Houston, over this whole conference, over the speakers, over us, and over your household as well. You know, we need the Holy Spirit in such a time as this. Jill, the person who's speaking tonight, how do you know him?
Well, I'm excited about tonight's message. I always love GYC. Craig and I look forward to coming and seeing what God has for us, what God has for the audience here and those at home. But tonight's speaker is Pastor Stephen Conway. He and his wife Tamara minister in the Michigan Conference. He's a pastor at the Cherry Hill and Detroit Northwest Church there in Detroit. But we went to school with him. Greg and I went to school with him, I don't even like to say this, but 20 years ago in college.
How 20, many?
20. Well, we won't repeat that
okay,
again.
Okay. Yeah, yeah,
oh,
yeah,
we won't
yeah,
tell them.
Yeah, that's true.
So 20 years ago, we went to college together, and at that time, Steve had a passion for ministry, a passion for evangelism and the Word of God. And his message tonight is entitled Witness. And not only tonight, but each one of the evening meetings, he will be bringing us the message. You can see right here, they have stood in the convention hall for our theme song. So let's join them on the stage right now.
To die. Good evening, GYC. How many of you have been blessed today? I tell you, my soul has been fed. I was so blessed, especially this afternoon. Well, everything that's happened today has been such a blessing to me, but I'll tell you, like, the highlight of my Sabbath so far was watching the family up here singing, "Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am a life that was changed." I was just crying. Praise God. Praise God that we have the opportunity to be involved in service for Him. It is such an honor. And today I have the most wonderful group of people here with me, people that are tangibly, currently involved in mission in their part of the world. And what is so important, I have the privilege of working as the assistant to the president of GYC. And what my department basically does is we work with affiliates. That's just a fancy way of saying with young people that are passionate about bringing the GYC experience to their local area. And so this is the wonderful group, the people that I have behind me, this is the wonderful group of people, not all of them, but some of them, that are involved in bringing GYC to their local area. And so we're gonna run down the line and just find out where they're from. And the ones that are on stage with me tonight are all from North America. I'll just put that on the table right now. We are also gonna hear from ones that are outside of North America on Monday night, so that will also be a treat. But for tonight, we're just gonna be hearing from those that are from North America. And as you hear their regions, where they're from, just tune your ears in to maybe that's your region and you would want to be involved in their conference as well. So let's go down and start at this end. Tell us where you're from, your affiliate, and what region you cover, and any other details that we need to know.
So we're GYC Northwest. We cover the territory of the North Pacific Union Conference, and our next convention is going to be March 27th through 31, 2019. Immediately preceding that, we'll have a pre-conference outreach from March 25 through 27. We'll be in Spokane, Washington, so we hope to see you there.
Tremendous. And then here we have a wonderful contingency from Northwest, and then tell me where you are from.
I am from Northern California, and I'm representing GYC West. We cover Northern and Central California. Our conference is June 5th through 9th. It's going to be at Albion Field Station up the Mendocino Coast. Follow us on Instagram for more information, GYC West.
Fantastic. And?
I represent GYC Canada. We cover all of Canada, and our conference dates are August 15th to 18th in 2019 in Ottawa, Canada.
Thank you. Wonderful. All right. And coming on down the line.
Hello, my name is Christian. I represent GYC Espanol for the North American Division, and we will be having our first youth rally in Jersey City, New Jersey, February 8th and February 9th.
Fantastic, thank you.
I represent GYC Southeast, and we're located on the campus of Southern Adventist University, and we will be having our spring conference partnering with Army Bible Camp this April 3rd through 6th, followed by a youth-led evangelistic seminar.
Amen. And coming on down the line.
Hello, I'm representing GYC Atlantic. Our territory extends from Maine as far south as Maryland and the Virginias. And so our conference is coming up in July of 2019 in Phoenixville, Pennsylvania. So if the GYC Atlantic region is where you call home, definitely we would love to see you there. And you can go to the GYC booth for some more information on that.
Fantastic. And here at the end.
We represent GYC Carolina. We cover North and South Carolina. And for our next event, we will be sponsoring Adventist Outreach Kids, a smaller youth organization to the east of us. And that will be June 7th through 8th, and the theme is Higher Ground.
So as you can see, they cover basically all of North America. And as they were sharing, you were paying attention, that's my part of the country, and I would love to get more involved with people in my region, because it's so inspiring to come here to GYC and to experience, you know, meeting so many different people, and it's wonderful, but also during the year, we still need that encouragement, we still need that community of young people around us that are inspired, that are seeking to follow God. And so I would strongly encourage you to plug in with the affiliates. Also, in addition to that, if you want more information, go to the exhibit hall and go to the GYC booth, and there at the GYC booth, kind of next to it, you will be able to talk to the affiliates. So you'll be able to connect with the ones that are in your region, learn more about them. I want to just highlight a little bit more. GYC Canada, I know that you used to be kind of ministering to Eastern Canada, and now you are covering all of Canada. Tell me a little bit more about that. Tell me about what you're doing, what your event is. Just some more details for our group here.
Yes, so we're so excited because for the past 10 years or so, we've been known as GYC Eastern Canada, and this past summer, we have expanded nationwide to GYC Canada. Amen? So it is a big responsibility, a lot of area to cover, a lot of events to put on, but it is also the responsibility for the Canadians that are here in the audience, as well as watching online, to please become involved in GYC Canada. We have missions. We have a pre-conference right before August 13th and 14th called Compassion Health, where we run a mega clinic, and it'll be in Ottawa this year, and we'd really love all young people to get involved, whether you're a young professional or a student. We need your help, so please come and find us at the booth or visit our website to become involved.
Amen. You know, I love Canada. It is big. It is beautiful. There's lots of space, not as many people. All the more reason why, if you're a young person that's on fire for Christ in Canada, to be involved in your with GYC Canada. I also want to especially highlight GYC Espanol. They've been around for a while, but they're starting again with a new initiative. Tell us more about GYC Espanol. What is your target? What are you trying to reach out to? And then what do you have going?
So what we have going on right now, we're just starting like our first youth rally on February 8th and 9th. But our goal is to reach all the Hispanic young adults in the North American division who do not speak English. Oftentimes, they don't come to these type of events because they're scared, because they won't understand, despite of translation, but we're trying to reach those young adults who are not coming to the big conference. And we want them to be able to receive the Three Angels messages as well. Amen. And know about evangelism too.
Amen. Amen. So tell us a little bit more. You said that you're starting this rally and you're doing it in Jersey City, is that correct?
Yes.
And tell us a little bit more about that.
So we will be having our event in Jersey City, New Jersey. I invite all my New Jersey peeps to support. And also invite all your friends from the East Coast who are Hispanic to attend this event. There will be more information on the GYC Espanol page. And also, if you go to the GYC booth, we are in need of many volunteers. So please sign up and don't be scared because the Lord will use you.
Amen. And if you know someone, a young person who is Spanish speaking or who is connected in with the Spanish speaking community, reach out to them. You know, it's a difficult thing if you feel somewhat isolated by language. So we want to reach out, be very warm, and get those young people plugged into GYC Espanol. Of course, we would love to have them here at GYC, but if there's a bit of a language barrier, a place where they can really feel comfortable and that they're relating to those who are resonating with their same language. Now, just before we have to step down, I wish you could hear stories from all of these affiliates. They are so tremendous. But since we're low on time, I'm just going to swing back around to GYC Northwest. Tell us a little bit about what you have coming up.
All right, so on March 16th, 2019, this coming year, we'll be holding a multi-site Global Youth Day outreach project in collaboration with the World Church. So if you are at a local church in the Northwest, we want you to get involved. So you can go to gycnorthwest.org and sign up, get involved, and we look forward to working with you.
Amen. Thank you so much. And I just want to encourage you again, swing by the booth, talk to the affiliates, pay attention to when their conference is happening, get involved, encourage young people that may not have come to GYC here to be able to come, because often the blessing of going to a GYC affiliate in your region is that you don't have then the airfare or the travel across the country, whatever it may be. You can get involved in that event with less difficulty, perhaps, or a young person that's maybe not very connected. You can draw them in and get them involved. Get them involved in outreach. Get them involved in the study of the Word of God and share the location of the affiliates with friends that you know that are around. So swing around, connect with them, hear their stories, get involved, and enjoy the meeting tonight. God bless.
GYC, although the Sabbath may be coming to an end, we have more blessings in store. Amen? Amen. I'm really excited. As the affiliates file off, Behind me, I will be joined by all of our seminar presenters for the rest of this weekend. Tomorrow morning, there will be 2 seminar presentations, and then on Monday, there will be 4 over the entire day. We want to take this time to allow the seminar presenters a little bit of time to introduce their topics, to really allow you to understand what they'll be talking about. We want to find the best fit for you in seminars. We want you to go to the seminar that God is calling you to. So as you listen, please prayerfully consider each one of the speakers. Allow their message to just soak in and understand what they have to present. We want you to end up at the right seminar for you. So I'm going to begin down here. I love each and every one of these individuals. Sometimes pastors have a tendency to talk for a long time. We don't have a lot of time this morning or this evening. So I'm going to be holding the mic for each one of these individuals. Have mercy upon me if it's a little awkward, but I'm going to be holding the mic just to make sure that we stay on time. Thank you guys so much for your patience. Here we go.
Why did you say that before you interviewed me?
He's a great pastor. Amen.
So in my class, we're going to be talking about how to rewild the Seventh-day Adventist Church to bring the danger back. And so in my class, we're going to be talking about how to get involved in one-year mission, Mission Caleb, Global Youth Day, and all the initiatives we have to help young people live dangerously for Jesus.
Amen. Thank you.
Well, that was pretty good. Well, God is on a mission in this world, and you are part of it. I am part of it. Every young person, every old person is part of this. Amen. But this workshop is going to be for young professionals, especially if you're in health ministry, but it isn't exclusively for health people, right? And what we're going to do is we're going to go through a series of steps to be able to encounter with God what it is that he's calling you to do and to be able to commit to that.
Amen.
I'm here with the General Conference Office of Adventist Mission, and I'm here because your church wants you. We are going to be looking at how you can connect with mission. We need tent makers who are able to go into places in the world where missionaries can't go. We need church planters who are able to start churches within your own communities and your own cultures and with the groups that are being missed in your own place right now. We need young people who are willing to go into the cities and be the hands of Jesus in the cities. And where, well, there's very little Adventist presence in many of them. We also need people that are willing and able to translate the gospel into the worldview of Buddhists and Hindus and Muslims, which is not an easy thing to do. So we're going to be talking about all of those things. Jesus said that he promised to be with us to the end, and we're here to send you to the end of the earth.
Amen. Amen. Some of you might be confused. They haven't said their names, so I apologize. We caught it. This is Elder Blanchard. This is Dr. Charles Marcel. This is Elder Scoggins. And hopefully, the rest of you have learned from their example. And now you will introduce yourselves by your names. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
My name is Anthony Bosman.
Amen.
Thank you. I'll be leading the interactive seminar called Atheism, Apatheism, or Adventism. Atheism presents intellectual challenges to faith. Is there a God? Has science replaced faith? Should we still take Genesis seriously? Apatheism is spiritual apathy. Why does this matter? Why should I care? But Adventism is so compelling that we have credible responses to give to the atheist, and we have a beautiful picture of God that can awaken someone out of apathy. So I invite you to join us, to be prepared, to be equipped, to always give a response to those who ask for the reason for the hope that is in you.
Amen. Thank you, Anthony.
Hi, I'm Siku Dako, and my seminar is going to be entitled Cosmic Conflict. You know, the great controversy is a meta-narrative, which means a story that is broad and a story behind a story that a lot of Adventists have known for a long time. What my seminar is going to be looking at is how does this story that's a story behind a story answer a lot of the contemporary questions that we have. So we're applying the great controversy as a worldview, as a framework to understand things like dress, entertainment, relationship stuff. Just we're applying the great controversy to real life issues and also to some philosophical questions like free will and the sovereignty of God. So you can look through your Attendify app. And lastly, I just want to say, The format is going to be kind of like, you know that aunt or uncle who talks a lot? Okay, I'm like already talking a lot. So it'll be kind of like that. And I'm going to be talking, and then you can get a word in edgewise. You can ask some questions, and at the end, we'll have time for question and answer and some interaction, too.
Awesome. Thank you, Siku.
You're welcome.
Hi, I'm Dan Cerns. Have you ever been asked, what is a Seventh-day Adventist? And then you fumble around with what to say. Well, we have three seminars. One is how to share the Adventist message in 30 seconds. Another, how to share the Seventh-day Adventist message in 5 minutes. And another, how to share the Adventist message in 30 minutes, depending on what time you have. You will be able to leave any of those seminars and immediately use that before you leave Houston and on your trip back. The last three seminars will deal with your local church. How do you find interests who are most receptive to be brought into this movement, brought to Jesus? How can you focus on the ripest fruit to bring them in? Another is, how do you mobilize people in ministry and mission? So many in our churches are sitting there, they sit, they soak, they sour, they get distracted by issues, but if they're engaged in ministry and mission, then they become excited in this final movement. And then the last one deals with how can we multiply groups that will help us plant more churches and activate more members and disciple more disciples. So those are the things, and the title is, You Are Needed.
Amen.
My name is Ron Kelly. My seminar is a Christian leadership series. It'll be three sessions that repeat. I'll be dealing with the issues of church governance, how to properly understand the use of terms that are being bantered around our church, how to conduct yourself with dignity and understanding in the milieu, and come away, as David was, wiser than his teachers because he was a humble student of God's word.
Excellent. One detail on his seminars, there's going to be three seminars that will be repeated a second time. So if you miss the first three, you can get them the second half. Just keep that in mind.
Good evening, GYC. My name is Dean Cullinane. I'm from the UK, and I have a question for you. How many of you know what the Bible is? None of you. The Bible is a book, and you know what we do with books? We read them. The thing is with the Bible is a lot of us have learned how to study it before we've learned how to read it. And that can get us in some trouble. So in my seminar, How to Read the Bible, we'll be taking this very book and this book alone and taking specific Bible characters, specific Bible stories, and looking to learn how we can get something from this book every single time we open it. So if you're looking for something relevant, something tangible, something that you can get in just a short time, then come to the seminar, How to Read the Bible.
Excellent. Thank you, Dean.
My name is Damon Sneed. The Three Angels' message is two components to it. We're told in great controversy that it's prophecy, which we know well, but it's also the everlasting gospel, which is also known as the third angel's message, the loud cry, the message of the true and faithful witness to the Laodiceans. It's what prepares the people for the great Advent shaken. And what's particular to this session is it prepares us for the latter rain of the Holy Spirit. So my seminar called The Wheel of Faith is going to uncover those missing components of the everlasting gospel. And those are the components that we usually miss. And without those, it renders the gospel power in our life ineffective. So we're going to get down into some of those juicy topics that will give us the experience of the gospel so that we can actually go forth and proclaim the gospel.
Now, I understand some of you might have gotten excited when you saw Henry Dent up here. Unfortunately, he is not presenting a seminar. He's simply filling in for a speaker who could not be here. So while I hate to disappoint you, Emery is going to be sharing a little bit about that.
Yes, so I'm not Dr. Siebold, but I'm introducing his seminar along with Dr. Jay Brand, his friend. It is called Launching Innovation, and this will be a workshop. Mind you, it's a workshop. This is not a typical seminar. I bought the supplies. You don't use popsicle sticks and glue and glitter and things like that in a normal seminar. We will be using in this seminar workshop design thinking is what it's called, using a process to be able to tackle an issue. This one on the table this year is evangelism and how to innovate through evangelism to reach the world.
Excellent. Thank you, Emery.
My name is Taj, and we're doing a seminar on the art of end time preaching, a 6-part seminar. And the justification for the existence of our seminar is the reality that The work of God is not going to get finished by adding members, but by multiplying messengers. It was only when all of Israel shouted that the walls of Jericho came crumbling down. And in the same way, it's only when all of us, the whole church, uses their voices that the loud cry message will be heard in all the world and the walls of Babylon will come crumbling down. So God wants to use all of our voices. But the question is how? How can we speak in such a way that will arrest the attention of a postmodern, media-saturated, desensitized world? We're going to learn those principles in our seminar, The Art of End Time Preaching, how to preach just like Jesus did. Jesus knew exactly what to say, how to say it, and the right timing of which to say it. And so in our seminar, we'll be covering those principles. It's a seminar that it was written for the inexperienced introvert, the lay preacher, the seasoned speaker, and the expert orator alike. And so we want you to come to learn just to preach and to teach and to reach just like Jesus did. You look at the word preach, there are two other words in that word, the word each and reach. So we want to preach in such a way to reach each, but not each is reached the same way. But Jesus will teach us how to do that. And so I invite you to come and check it out.
Wow. Amen.
Amen. My name is Andy M. One area in our track record that we could improve upon is how we handle conflict. So we're going to engage in an experiment and do just that. We're going to deal with challenging topics like social justice, racism, and other issues. We have a group of panelists, and we want to really talk about these things head on.
Amen. Thank you, Andy.
My name is Melody Mason. How many of you have been enjoying the morning United Prayer time? Hasn't that been such a blessing? I believe that prayer is one of the best gifts that we have actually been given as a church and as a people. We're told in Ministry of Healing that prayer and faith will do what no power on earth can accomplish. So Jim Castor and I are actually going to be sharing a seminar together called Keys to Effective and Vibrant Prayer Ministry and how we can use this tool that God has given us for His glory. So we're looking forward to that.
Amen. Now, I wish you the best of luck as you decide which of these wonderful seminars you're going to attend. There's many great options that we have available. So as you decide, please prayerfully consider each one. There's more information about each seminar in the Attendify app and in your program booklets. So as you make your decision, you can use those resources to help you and guide that decision. Thank you so much and have a great evening.
A difficult decision, huh? A very difficult decision. So you know what, my dear friends? My suggestion is do not make it for yourself. Go to the prayer room tomorrow morning. Amen? I'm serious. This decision, just imagine how many beautiful and wonderful opportunities here to grow your ministry. And this is the reason why that I would like to encourage you to go to the prayer room, because you will have the Lord's leading. When God is the one choosing for you, you'll never go wrong. Can you say amen? Amen. That amen is a very, very weak amen. Amen?
Amen.
So everyone who said amen, I'll expect you to the prayer room tomorrow. So before I go on promoting the prayer room, I'd like to introduce to you to my friend here beside me, Josh. And this is another guy whose life was changed because of what the Lord has done to him in the prayer room. And Josh, you have a very interesting introduction to the prayer room. What happened when someone invited you to go to the prayer room?
Well, Jim, as some of you know, last year the prayer room was open at 6 a.m. Now, a lot of you don't bat an eye to that since it starts at 5:45 tomorrow. Hope you all come. But anyways, so I was not planning to go. It's 6 o'clock. I am not a morning person. I wasn't then. So something like a prayer meeting in the morning, that totally crossed my mind. I didn't care. But someone prodded me to go, and so I went just for their sake because I didn't want to offend them. But when I went, it was such a wonderful experience. It's probably one of the most crucial turning points in my life, just being able to attend the prayer meeting.
And by the way, that person who invited Josh was their youth leader, Leia. I had to mention her name. Leia is the one whom I have been inviting 2 years ago. And she said, okay, I'll come. But she did not show up until the last day. And then the last day after the prayer session, she was there bawling in tears. And she was crying, saying, why did I come just now? And she brought her church youth during that time. How many of you came during that year? Yeah, last year.
Oh, around 10 people, 11 people.
Together with your parents?
No, not my parents. Not my parents yet.
Oh, but some of the parents came.
Yes, that's right.
And what happened in the prayer room that really changed your life?
Well, it was the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. That's definitely the crucial thing there. But everybody just in the prayer room, all united for the Holy Spirit, just calling upon the Holy Spirit, pouring out their heart, like giving out their burdens, and everybody just encouraging each other. No matter if you're an introvert or an extrovert, everyone there can find Jesus.
Okay, so what happened when you went back home?
Well, as you can see, I was just here a minute ago as one of the GYC affiliates from Canada. So I just asked God, I asked in prayer, during that prayer meeting, what would you like me to do? Whatever you tell me to do, I will do it. I thought that would mean stacking up chairs and putting up some benches, because that's what I like to do as an introvert. I like to be in the back line supporting. But God had other plans for me, and he said, no, you will be the VP logistics for GYC Canada. You are 18 years old, no experience, fresh into university, but by not your strength, but my strength, you will be a good witness.
Amen. Do you want your life to be changed, friends? You have to be in the presence of God. And this is one amazing thing, because I went to their church last February, and the moment I arrived in their church, this church is just alive. This young people, 15 years old to like 19 years old, and their parents told me, Jem, it is such a joy to see your kid up in the pulpit. Before they were pew warmers, now they're fire starters. They're now arsonists for the Lord. Isn't it amazing? And God is just changing one life after another. And that will not happen, my dear friends, if we will not do our part and spend time in the presence of God. Can you say amen? Again, it's a very, very low-tone amen. And this is a good news that I'd like to tell you. We have a few more prayer sessions that's going to happen. And Josh, before you say that, I'd just like to remind you, friends, that we have a prayer room at Ballroom B, third floor, and we will start prayer session at 5:45. The singing starts at 5:45, and I encourage you not to miss it. And by the way, tomorrow afternoon, while the group is out doing outreach, we will spend 2 hours praying for this group of people who are doing the outreach. So we will have 2 hours of intercessory prayer. So if the Lord convicts you to join the intercessory prayer, come and join us in the prayer room. And friends, I'd like to read a quote, a beautiful quote here that says, only those who constantly receive fresh supplies of grace will have ability to use that power bestowed by the Holy Spirit. Amen? Only those who constantly receive, and we will not constantly receive if we will not come in the presence of God. And friends, it says here, even Christ during his life on earth sought his Father daily for the fresh supplies of grace. If Christ himself did that, my dear friends, we need it even more, especially now. Can you say amen again? Okay. And lastly, it says here, the messengers whom he says fit to send are weak and erring, but to all who gives themselves to his service, he promises divine aid. Friends, we have nothing to fear if God is with us. And we have to spend that time in the presence of God. And friends, I'd like to encourage you, come to the prayer room. You will never regret it. This is something that's worth sacrificing for, because most of you are saying, oh, Jem, it's 6 o'clock. Friends, you are not waking up 5 o'clock every day of your life. You only have until Monday to do it. Amen? So at least one day, try and come in the presence of God. And some people ask me this question, Jem, where do you get your energy? It seems like you're just like bursting. And I told them, my dear friends, I told you, I only have 2 hours sleep last night. This is not my energy, my dear friends. This energy only comes from spending time in the presence of God. So some of you might be afraid that you might lose strength, that you may be sleepy for the rest of the day. My dear friends, I tell you, it's the other way around. You'll receive strength, strength for your weakness that is exchanged in the presence of God. So Josh, what do you want to tell our brothers and sisters who have not yet visited the prayer room?
Not visiting the prayer room is basically like missing half of GYC. You need to attend. God has a plan for you, and that is the place to listen for it.
So friends, let's spend a few minutes right now praying. Let's be on our knees and ask for the Lord's leading. Our great God, our dear loving Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for giving us this wonderful opportunity to bow before you and to bow before you as a church and to come together and meet together. Lord, I pray in a very special way that you please continue to draw us closer and closer to your side. And Lord, I pray that as we continue with this convention, may each and every one of us will have the burden to draw closer to you and to ask for the outpouring of your Holy Spirit. Lord, we pray in a very special way for the seminars that's going to happen tomorrow. Lord, we ask that you please lead us and help us, Lord, to be in the position that we would be able to hear your voice, to hear your leading on which way do you want us to go. And Lord, we pray in a very special way for each and every speaker, and especially for the speaker that you have chosen tonight. May you cover him with your presence. May he not be seen. May only Jesus be lifted up, higher than we have lifted him up before. And Lord, we pray that you please pour upon us a full measure of your Spirit. For we ask this in the loving name of your Son, Jesus. All your children say, amen.
It is now time for the scripture reading. I'll be reading from Micah chapter 6, verses 1 through 8. Micah chapter 6, verses 1 through 8. And it reads, "Hear what the Lord says. Arise, plead your case before the mountains, and let the hills hear your voice. Hear, you mountains, the indictment of the Lord, and you enduring foundations of the earth. For the Lord has an indictment against his people, and he will contend with Israel. O my people, what have I done to you? How have I wearied you? Answer me. For I brought you up from the land of Egypt and redeemed you from the house of slavery. And I sent before you Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. O my people, remember what Balak, king of Moab, devised, what Balaam, the son of Beor, answered him, and what happened from Shittim to Gilgal, that you may know the righteous acts of the Lord. Verse 6, with what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves of a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000s of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body, for the sin of my soul? He has told you, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you, but to do justice, and to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God." I have the privilege of introducing our evening speaker tonight. He has a heart for GYC. In fact, he was a speaker at the very first GYC. His firstborn, Israel, was 6 months old. Today he's 16 and is attending the 17th GYC. He's a thinker, he's a lover of bow ties, it's why I'm wearing one tonight. He's a relationship and family specialist. You kind of earn that when you have 4 very active children. Steve Conway is also pastor of the Cherry Hill and Detroit Northwest churches, and married to the beautiful and perennial sanguine Tambi. He brings to the table a very unique experience that adds weighty depth to his preaching. First lasting memory of him was when I heard that an African-American brother was going to pastor a Korean church. And I remember thinking, that's gonna be very interesting. The Lord blessed. In fact, he pastored two Korean churches. He also served as a chaplain on the campus of the University of Michigan with Campus, the Center for Adventist Ministry to Public University Students, and has also served as the boys' dean at one of our academies. You can expect from Brother Conway the preaching of the word that both activates the mind and resonates with your soul. Here at GYC, we've accustomed to hearing profound, straightforward, biblical preaching from numerous preachers. That torch, that baton, will be held very high tonight and each evening to the end. Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the word of God. I pray that you will be with Pastor Steve Conway, that you will anoint his lips, that the words that are preached are not his own, but from on high. And may your spirit speak to each and every audience and beyond. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend. Who could have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescued the souls of men. Counselor, Comforter, Keeper, Spirit we long to embrace. You offer hope when our hearts have hopelessly lost the way. Oh, we've hopelessly lost the way. Your throne, oh, we're bowing before. healing and grace all hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger
for. Let's hear another hearty amen. Amen. Bow your heads together with me. Father, we are grateful for the privilege of your presence and for the power of your word. Now we ask that you would be with us as we spend time together considering eternal things. It is our prayer that we would leave different than we entered. In Jesus' name, amen. Bring you greetings from the Cherry Hill Seventh-day Adventist Church in Garden City, Michigan, and the Detroit Northwest Seventh-day Adventist Church in Detroit, Michigan. I'm grateful that our congregations have allowed us to come here and to spend time together with you and share. In the book of Acts, chapter 1, beginning with verse 6, the Bible says, when they therefore were come together, they asked of him, saying, Lord, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel? Wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel? Verse 7, and he said unto them, it is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father hath put in his own power. But ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth, or as the theme is, to the ends of the earth. The first thing that jumps into my mind is found in verse 6. The Bible tells us that when they were come together, they asked him, and in the original language, they did not merely ask one time, but they persistently pressed Jesus. So they asked over and over and over again. It's like one of my children, when I have told them that I'm going to do something for them, they will never let me forget. They press over and over and over again. But it is not this pressing so much as it is what the disciples ask that is at the very least puzzling to me. Lord, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel? If you're familiar with Jesus's teachings on the kingdom, which all of us should be to some degree, Jesus had much to say about the kingdom, but actually he said very little about the restoration of the kingdom to Israel. In his parables, you will read about the kingdom being removed or taken away from Israel and given to another nation, bringing forth fruits. And so my question is, where does the disciples' question come from? Beloved, I believe that it came from the theological interpretations of the Pharisees. Now, the reason why this is troubling to me is because the crucified and resurrected and glorified Savior was standing right there in front of the disciples. They had spent the last 40 days with their master. And beloved, Jesus was not enough. What did I say? I heard three people here on the front row. Jesus was not enough. What did I say? Please imagine with me that the man that you have seen raise the dead and feed 5,000 on one occasion and 4,000 on another occasion, and that's not even counting the women and children. A man that you have seen calm stormy seas. A man that you have seen cast demons out of countless individuals. And then imagine with me that you see this same man hanging on a cross. Your hopes in him as the Messiah are dashed, destroyed. And then you see him after he has risen. Imagine that you're inside of a house for fear of what the Jews are going to do to you, and this same Jesus walks through the wall, comes into the midst, approaches Thomas, and says, "Touch me. Touch me." And then imagine that you and Jesus spend 40 days together. And at the end of this, the only thing on your lips is a twisted theological interpretation. When will you restore the kingdom to Israel? Not Jesus, how many more people are going to be resurrected? Not Jesus, what grand things do you have in store for us, but when will you restore the kingdom to Israel? It makes me wonder tonight, for how many of us is Jesus not enough? How many of us need a new car? How many of us need another degree? How many of us need a better relationship? How many of us need to make more money? How many of us need something else other than Jesus? The disciples asked this ridiculous question, but Jesus, in his manifold wisdom, does not directly address the question. It is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father hath put in his own power, but ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth. This is a wonderful promise, and we've heard a little bit about it today. Your theme takes the end of verse 8 and seeks to focus our minds on that. But I want to take your minds away from the ends of the earth, and I want to take your minds to the beginning. Jesus tells them to go to Jerusalem. He tells them to go where? Now, I don't know if you're awake this evening, but if you're like me and I'm one of the disciples, I'm like, what, Jesus? You want us to go where? After all, it was in Jerusalem that Jesus had been, in the 11th chapter of John's gospel, the Bible tells us how Jesus' apostles felt about Jerusalem when Jesus said, "Let us go into Judea," because he wanted to resurrect Lazarus. They said, "Well, yeah, come on, let's go so we can die like him." This was not a place that any one of Jesus' followers would covet going, and yet it is the very first place that Jesus commanded that his disciples must go. I would submit to you this evening that Jesus was borrowing from a principle or an idea that is in Scripture. Again, if I'm one of the disciples, I don't want to go to Jerusalem because they've crucified Jesus. Not only have they crucified Jesus, but they've already heard Jesus preaching. They've seen Jesus perform miracles. Humanly speaking, one would conclude it would be a waste of time to go and take the gospel message to those who have apparently already heard. If there were classes of people who were deserving to receive the gospel, I believe that those in Jerusalem would probably be considered amongst the most undeserving. And yet Jesus said, before you reach the ends of the earth, you must first go to Jerusalem. What is this principle that we suggested? Turn with me to Micah chapter 6. It was our scripture reading this evening. Micah chapter 6. People have composed beautiful music, beautiful songs about these verses, but tonight we will try to extract something that helps us understand Jesus' command in the first chapter of Acts. Hear ye now what the Lord says. Arise, contend thou before the mountains, and let the hills hear your voice. Whenever God has a problem with his people and they're not listening, God calls nature to witness against his people. Verse 2, hear ye, O mountains, the Lord's controversy, and ye strong foundations of the earth. For the Lord has a controversy with his people, and he will plead with Israel. O my people, what have I done unto you? And wherein have I wearied you? Testify against me. For I brought you up out of the land of Egypt and redeemed you out of the house of servants, and I sent before you Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. O my people, remember now what Balak, king of Moab, consulted and what Balaam, the son of Beor, answered him from Shittim unto Gilgal, that ye may know the righteousness of the Lord. Now here's where it gets interesting. Verse 6, Israel personified is responding to God's accusations. And I want you to notice the tenor of their response. Wherewith shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before the high God? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves of a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with 10,000s of rams or with 10,000s of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? So God says, I've got a controversy with my people. And Israel's response is, well, what do you want from us? What do you want? Do you want thousands of burnt offerings? Do you want thousands of rams, 10,000s of rivers of oil? Those things are all in reference to the sacrificial or the ceremonial services. Do you want us to just keep going through a round of religious practices? Is that what you want, God? More churches? More grand events like this one? More seminars? More explanations on how we are to do this and how we are to do that? Is that what you desire? And then Israel goes a step further and suggests that God is unfair in what he desires. Beyond the religious rituals, do you want me to give the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? Are you asking me for that which it is uncharacteristic of you to request, illogical of you to request? God, what is it that you want from me? I imagine that there are some of you who are listening to this right now who have asked yourselves the very same question. God, I go to church every week. God, I try to study my Bible. I try to spend time with you, but it seems like things are just not clicking. What else do you want from me? I've sacrificed and I've given up music and I've given up the partying scene and I've tried to get away from the old life, but what else is it that you desire? Listen to God's response. Verse 8. What does it say? You probably can quote it. He hath showed thee, O man, what is? And what doth the Now, the interesting thing is, if you're like me, I'm looking at that and I'm saying to myself, okay, God has shown them what it is that is good and what he requires of them, so they already know. They already what? They already know. But if you're like me, I didn't know. Here's the punchline, if you will. Israel had been shown what God required of them based on his treatment of Israel. Let me say that again. Israel had been shown what God required of them based on his treatment of Israel. Listen to this. Verse 4. For I brought you up out of the land of Egypt, and I redeemed you out of the house of slavery. And I sent before you Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. God is saying, I have liberated you. I have what? I have liberated you. And I also gave you guidance and leadership. I gave you what? I liberated you. I provided guidance and leadership for you. Verse 5. Remember now what Balak, king of Moab, consulted and what Balaam, the son of Beor, answered him. Now listen, you guys remember this. This is from the book of Numbers, right? Did Israel know what Balaam and Balak were doing on the mountain? Did Israel know that an attempt was being made to curse the entire nation? Come on, yes or no? Listen to me, friends. God was saying, I protected you from dangers that you did not even know existed. I protected and I preserved you. I caused blessings to come from your enemies and you didn't even know it. And so this, beloved, is the foundation for why God says, I have shown you what is good, and I have shown you what I require of you. Listen to what he says in the end portion of verse 8. To do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with thy God. To do justly. That is to do what is right. To do what is right. And to love mercy. And then to walk in humility. We should love mercy. Israel was being encouraged to love mercy because God had been merciful to them. Israel was being encouraged to do what was right because God had done right by Israel. Israel was being encouraged to walk in humility because the blessings that they enjoyed were not because they had been faithful to God, but because God had been faithful to them. And so God says this, beloved, I want you to treat others the way that I have treated you. Did you get that or did you miss it? I want you to treat others the way I have treated you. But what if they're undeserving? Well, guess what? You're undeserving too. This principle, dear friends, I believe is what Jesus concentrates in the first chapter of Acts. It's the reason why Jesus told the disciples that they must first go to Jerusalem. It was the most hazardous mission that they could undertake to the most undeserving group of people on the face of planet Earth, and yet Jesus says you must start there. Now let me ask you, did the disciples stick close to Jesus' side when he was going through his passion? You know, I had a friend when I was young, about 15 or 16. And I remember my brother and I, we got into a fight. We got jumped. And it was three of us walking down the street. And this brother was raptured away instantly when the fight broke out. And 2 hours later, he reappeared. And I'm like, man, what happened? Oh, man, I ran. I thought y'all was running too. Bible says that one of Jesus's followers ran so fast that the brother ran up out of his clothes. Now, I know some of you are fasting here tonight, but you ain't that fast. His brother ran up out of his clothes. The disciples, my point is this, the disciples were undeserving of the mercies of God because they had forsaken Jesus at the time when he needed them most, and yet he had extended mercy to them. And now Jesus says, I want you to go and extend mercy to the undeserving, just as I have extended mercy to you. Let me ask you a question tonight. Who do you think is undeserving of the gospel? Let me ask it another way. Who are you least inclined to share the gospel with? I want you to think about that. Somebody alluded to it earlier today in one of the presentations. I like the fact that Jerusalem was a city. Jerusalem was a what? Now, I know as all good Seventh-day Adventists, we're trying to make our way to the hills and get away from the cities so we can prepare to be translated to heaven without seeing death. But I just want to put this in your ear tonight. There is work to be done in the cities. And I know some of us talk about being afraid of going to the cities. I didn't hear no amens on that. I know some of us talk about being afraid of going into the cities because, oh, all the crime and all the violence. I heard that about Detroit. But they pack out Ford Field with 80,000 people all the time. They pack out Tigers, not Tiger Stadium, but Comerica Park. All the folks going down to see the baseball game. And they pack out the hockey arenas. And people tend to go to the cities for what they want to go to the cities for. And I'm not just talking about worldly folks. I'm talking about us too. We'll come to the city for GYC, but we won't go to labor amongst those who are needy in the cities. And yet what we're reading tonight from God's word is, God says, have I extended mercy to you? Yes. Then I expect you to extend mercy even to those that you may deem to be undeserving. Well, Lord, I'm afraid of what's going to happen if I go into the cities. Let me tell you, I used to, for many years, like many of you, or some of you anyway, go door to door canvassing, and I led programs, big booked, and all of that stuff. And you know what they would tell us when we would go door to door? And, you know, you don't know the people that were telling me this, so don't think anything. They would tell us there are certain communities that you want to look for. Don't say amen too loud. Young families with kids. These are the communities that we want to target. And when we conduct our evangelistic crusades, listen to me, beloved, who are we expecting to get? If you're honest with yourselves, you want nicely dressed professionals who have well-mannered families, who have good jobs to join your church. I heard one amen. We want people who are as close to us as they possibly can be to come and join our churches. And we are uncomfortable when people don't look like us. We are uncomfortable when we smell them. We're uncomfortable when their coming means that our church is going to have to expend more of its budget in order to bless and care for them. You mean we spent all this money on evangelism and now we're going to have to keep spending? I thought we were trying to get good. And yet Jesus says, you didn't deserve my mercy or my grace. And so I am imploring you to extend my mercy and my grace to others just as I have extended it to you. In fact, beloved, let me say this. The love and mercy of God ought to change us. It ought to change us at our very core so that we are willing to go first to the people and the places that are most undeserving or that we deem as most undeserving, the people and places that we are most uncomfortable going to. If you only want people who look like you and who are in the same socioeconomic bracket as you are, what gospel are you talking about? What message are you taking? If I read my Bible correctly, Jesus went to the sick, diseased, and the outcast of society first. The most undeserving. Why? Because they were the most likely to accept his message and be transformed by it. But you and I want folks who are ready-made Christians. Let me tell you, we had a precious sister. We had outside service at the Cherry Hill Church. Precious sister. She was drove up and down the street 5 times. She ended up coming in and she said she wanted to bring her whole family. We said, sure, come on in. And so she came with her family. Precious family, beautiful family. 5 children. 2 of her children were autistic. And this made our church uncomfortable. Now, here we are praying that the Lord brings souls. Then he brings some. And we're like, oh. But here's what it forced us to do. And I praise God for my saints at Cherry Hill. We decided to get together and pray and say, God has sent us these precious souls, and we need to be equipped so that we can minister to them. And so we had a whole big thing and had folks from the Autism Alliance come in and tell us how we could better equip our church. Here's the thing we learned. Our Sabbath school was set up for our children and our grandchildren, but it wasn't set up for autistic children. Now, as I'm listening to this presentation that these folks from the Autism Alliance are sharing, it begins to settle in on my mind. Hey, it's not just our Sabbath school program. Our entire church service is set up for our own comfort. And just like an autistic child could come into a Sabbath school room and be completely out of place, and we don't even understand why, and it means that we must invest and take the time to get to know that child so that we can minister to them in a relevant way. Likewise, it's not just with autistic children, but it's with everybody, beloved. Before you go to the ends of the earth, first start in the most undesirable place. 1997, I was supposed to go to Korea to teach English. The plans fell through. I was reading somewhere in the Spirit of Prophecy, and this powerful quotation came, and it said that those who seek to be missionaries in a foreign land must first learn to become missionaries in their own homes. In their own homes. Lord, have mercy. It ain't easy at home, is it? Because folks know you. No matter how high you were walking at GYC, they like, I'm going to give it a week. See if you ain't back to doing the same old foolishness you was doing before you went. And it's uncomfortable when people want to test the validity of our experience, isn't it? Don't we just want people to accept that we've changed and we're new? But the people in our homes are like, let's see how long it's going to last this time. Because they've been on that rodeo before. Oh, my heart was touched. Let's see if you're going to continue to be patient. Let's see if you're going to continue to walk with humility. And beloved, here it is. Jesus wants us to begin. He wants us to what? He wants us to begin in the most difficult places. I was in Tennessee, and pastor by the name of George Sharp came and visited me. I was a boys dean at Laurel Brook Academy, and he came and sat me down. He said, "Steve, listen, I think that God has placed his hand on you for pastoral ministry. Have you ever considered that?" I'm like, "No, not really." And this silver-haired, wise man laid a burden on me for over an hour. And beloved, I came face to face with this reality that I had surrendered to the Lord Jesus, but I had told him two things. I said, "Lord, I don't want to be a pastor. I'll do anything, but I ain't about to be no pastor. Lord, I'll go anywhere, jungles, desert, but don't send me back to Cleveland." That's why I was born and raised in Cleveland, Ohio. And I'm like, no, Lord, literally, Lord, you can send me anywhere except for home. And Lord, I'll do anything except for pastor. And at the end of that conversation, and I have been walking with the Lord for about 5 or 6 years at this point, at the end of that conversation, I realized that I had never truly surrendered to God. Now, let me rephrase that. I realized that my surrender was not thorough. I had indeed surrendered, but it was not thorough because I was withholding things. There were places I did not, or a place, excuse me, singular, a place I did not want to go. And there was a task that I had no interest in fulfilling. Beloved, we read Acts chapter 1, verse 8, and we think, "Ye shall receive power," and that's where we focus. But you got to understand, folks, the disciples were not thinking about the power. They were thinking about where Jesus was telling them to go. Jerusalem. They would have preferred to go to the ends of the earth, but not Jerusalem. But that's precisely where Jesus sent them. Why? Because there would be no greater evidence that their hearts had been transformed by the love of God than for those men to go to Jerusalem and labor intensely and passionately for the same people who had not only crucified Jesus, listen to me, beloved, but who had seen their cowardice. The same people who had witnessed as they abandoned their master. Jesus said, "I want you to start right there." I want to ask you something this evening. Have you been changed by the mercy and grace that God has extended to you? Have you truly been transformed? I'm going to suggest tonight that perhaps you have been, but like me in Tennessee, you need a more thorough transformation. Last year, I was reading a book because I wanted to become a better father, specifically for my daughters. Wonderful book called Strong Fathers, Strong Daughters. And as I was reading this book, I came across a story about a father and his daughter. Christian family. Raising their children all to love and serve God. And then their oldest daughter decides to go into the parents' room and steal some precious things and money from the parents and takes off. Not a word to the parents about where she's going, why she's taking off. In fact, the mother and father hired a private investigator to find out where their daughter was. They lived in Michigan, and their daughter was tracked down all the way out in California. The father jumped on an airplane and he caught a flight out to California. His daughter was working in a convenience store, and so for about an hour and a half, the father comes and he just looks at his daughter. Doesn't say anything, just looks at her. He hadn't seen her in months. The daughter turns around. You know how you can tell when somebody's been staring at you for a long time? She turns around and sees her father, and when her break comes, she comes out to speak with her dad. Instead of receiving a warm embrace, she cusses her father out. Tells him that it's your fault that I'm here. It's your fault that I left home. Now, I don't know what home you grew up in, but the home I grew up in, you don't do that. You might lose some teeth or need some dental work or something like that. Lambasted him. Refused to talk to him anymore. The father hopped on a plane and went back home by himself, heartbroken. 6 months later, the father comes back. Maybe she's had a change of heart. He goes to the convenience store. He doesn't see his daughter. He asks around. She doesn't work here anymore. The father begins to search around the homeless shelters of the city, seeking to find his girl. He finds her up under a bridge. Her clothes are dirty. She is emaciated. He suspects that she's on drugs, maybe even prostituting herself to get the drugs. He bursts into tears and he runs to his girl, but there's still this coldness. He takes her to a store, buys her some clothes, asks her what's going on. She refuses to share anything. He discovers that she's been staying with a man who is twice her age. He pleads with his daughter, please, come home. No. The father returns, goes home. All this time, the father has a ritual. He is writing letters to his daughter on a weekly basis. And he's putting the letters away. Listen to me, beloved. He's putting the letters away, hoping that when she comes home, if she comes home, he'll give the letters to her. Not only is he writing letters, but unbeknownst even to his wife, he's taking a small sum of money and setting it aside in a special account for his daughter. One day, the father is at work, and his phone is just ringing and ringing and ringing. He's in a meeting, and he steps out and, hello? There's no sound on the other end of the line. Hello, sweetheart, is that you? Is that you? He hears his daughter's sobs on the other end of the line. Where are you? Tell me where you are and I will come and get you right now. She said, I'm in a bus station in Grand Rapids. The father hung up the phone. He jumped in his vehicle, told everybody he would be back tomorrow. He drove to that bus station, picked up his little girl and brought her home. I've got to confess to you tonight. When I read that story, I put myself in that father's place. And I said, I don't know if I could love my daughter like that after she has treated me like that. One reality settled in on my mind, actually two. The first reality was this. Stephen, you don't really know what love is yet. Because your love, even for your precious children, has not been tested like that yet. The second reality that settled in on my mind is this: Stephen, why would you be unwilling to love your own children that way when that's how I've loved you? That's how I've loved you. That's what you've done to me. That's how you've exasperated my love. That's how you've resisted and refused my love. But Stephen, I've been writing love letters to you. I've been storing away the blessings for you when you come back. And Stephen, I don't just want you to come back, but I want you to go and get others too. Go get someone else who has exasperated your patience and your love like you have exasperated mine. Go get them. As this special music is shared with you, I want you to think about the love of God and whether you need a more thorough experience with that love. And I'm going to ask you to do something after this special music is shared.
Life was formed in your hands. You alone tell my story. All my hours like sand, I surrender all. Through the battle I'll sing, Lord, I know you are for me. My whole heart I will bring, I surrender all. In you I find rest, I find rest.
From an ocean of tears, I surrender all.
For your word is my sword, and your arms are my fortress. I know victory is yours, I surrender all. In you I find rest, I find rest.
I want to ask you to do these two things. First thing I want to ask you is this: if you, like me, can acknowledge that you need a deeper revelation of God's love because there are places that you don't want to go and people that you are uncomfortable ministering to, but you understand that if God has loved me, then it means that I've got to love others. And I've got to extend the same mercy and grace that's been extended to me. That's appeal number one. If you feel that you need a deeper revelation of God's love, my second appeal is this: if there are people in your life that you have not found the grace to be able to forgive, and it is stunting your spiritual growth, it is keeping you from experiencing fullness of joy, it's keeping you from experiencing rest and peace, and you want to say, Lord, transform me by your grace and your love so that I'm able to extend that grace and love to these particular people in my life. Two simple things. Bow your heads with me and close your eyes. I'm not going to ask you to come forward tonight. I want you to simply talk with God. Lord, help me. Help me. There are people I don't love like you do. There are places that I'm unwilling to go. The ends of the earth sounds better to me than going to these places. And yet, just like Jesus' command to the disciples, before I can reach the end of the earth, I must first reach the end of myself. So, Lord, help me. Lord, help me. I'll give you a minute. Just talk to the Lord. Loving Father, tonight we just want to say thank you. Thank you for liberating us. Thank you for giving us guidance. Thank you for protecting us when we didn't know we needed to be protected. Just like you said to ancient Israel, tonight you have also shown us already what is good and what you require of us. It is a righteousness that reflects your righteousness. A righteousness that extends love and grace and mercy even to the undeserving. Father, if we don't have this resonating in our hearts, what we say with our lips does not matter. The soundness of our message is compromised if this is not residing in our hearts. Lord, tonight we want to be transformed by you and what you have done and are doing for us. Wrap your loving arms around each and every one of your precious children tonight. May your grace, richly and freely bestowed upon us, be uppermost in our thoughts on this night, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.